Hello, this is going to be our last chapter for this course. In this chapter, we will study some abstract algebraic structures and particular rings and groups, and we will see some applications of these abstract objects in cryptography. So, I start with something called rings. And in this first lecture, we will look at their basic properties and, of course, the basic definitions. A ring, so this is the basic definition of a ring. It is a set R along with two binary operations, which are typically denoted as addition and multiplication. Is called a ring if for all a, b, c, for all elements a, b, c in R, we have the following conditions. Okay, so first of all, plus and dot are two binary operations, and therefore this means it takes two arguments, typically a and b. So, we can write a plus b instead of plus a comma b. Okay, so a plus b should be again an element of R, and a dot b or a b should be again an element of R. So, binary operations are by definition closed. Okay, so let us see which conditions must be satisfied in order that this set R along with two operations qualify as a ring. First one is, for all AB, A plus B should be equal to B plus A, which means addition is commutative. Likewise, for every ABC, this says that addition should be associative. So, these are standard properties. Now, there is something called an additive identity. So, R must contain some element which we denote by 0 or maybe by z. Okay. Such that for every element A, if you add 0 with A, this side or this side, we must have A. Okay. So, this 0 is called the additive identity. Okay. You may use some other symbols like z or something like that for denoting the 0. This is one of the most common notations. And not only that, for every element A, there exists a B such that A plus B equal to B plus A equal to 0. So, this B is called the additive inverse of A in R. And we typically denote this as minus A. Okay. So, these four properties pertain to addition. Multiplication, we require associativity, that is, for every A, B and C, we should have AB times C equal to A times BC. Okay. So, that is commutative. Sorry. Dot is, this is a mistake. Dot is not commutative. Dot is associative. Dot is associative. Okay, printing mistake, typo. Anyway, dot should be associative. Commutativity of multiplication is not by default a definition, a part of the definition. There is another thing dot should be distributive over plus. Okay, so this has changed, but anyway, so you always consider this as associative. Okay. So that means distributivity means A dot B plus C same as A dot B plus A dot C. Another direction also, A plus B dot C is A dot C plus B dot C. So these six properties of the operations define a basic ring. Now, there may be additional properties satisfied by particularly this dot operation. So, for example, the ring is called a commutative ring if dot is commutative. That is, A dot B is equal to B dot A for all A and B. And we also talk about rings with multiplicative identity or multiplicative unity. So, R is called a ring with identity or a ring with unity if there exists some element typically denoted as 1, or you may write U, something like that. There exists 1 such that for all A, 1 dot A equal to A dot 1. Okay, again there is a mistake. Equal to A. For all A in R. Okay. That is, one is called the unity or multiplicative identity or just identity. Okay. So, 1 dot A is equal to A dot A. A dot 1 is equal to A. This is once again a mistake. Sorry. Okay. So, basic ring satisfies this sixth property, and if dot is commutative, then the ring is also called commutative. If there is an identity, multiplicative identity, we call it a ring with identity or a ring with unity. Okay. Let us see several examples. First, standard sets, integers, rational numbers, real numbers, complex number, and the standard addition and multiplication are all commutative rings with identity. You can check this very easily. Now, what about matrices? So, by this, MNZ, I consider the set of all n by n matrices with integer entries. Instead of Z, I can also talk about entries from rational numbers, entries from real numbers, entries from complex numbers. These sets are rings under standard matrix addition and multiplication. But we know that matrix multiplication is not commutative, so these rings are not commutative. However, this ring contains the multiplicative identity element, which is the n by n identity matrix. Okay. Then let us look at a little bit non-trivial example. Let S be a set. In order to make it meaningful, let us say that S contains at least two elements. This may even be infinite. Now consider this power set. This is a commutative ring with identity under the operations. This is the addition in power set of S. This is symmetric difference. So for two subset A and B, A delta B is nothing but A minus B union B minus A. That is the set of all elements that belong to A or B, but not both. And the product is intersection. Okay. You can easily see that the additive identity is the empty set, whereas the multiplicative identity is the entire set S. And the additive inverse of A is A itself. Okay. So I leave it to you to verify that all the ring axioms are satisfied by this power set of S along with these two operations, symmetric difference and intersection. Then there is a very related thing. Let us consider some positive integer greater than or equal to 2 and consider the set of all n-dimensional or n-bit vectors This is again a commutative ring with identity under the bitwise XOR and bitwise AND operations. Take two vectors, bit by bit you make XOR, so that is the plus, and bit by bit you make the logical AND. This is the product operation. This is once again a commutative ring with identity. The zero vector is the additive identity and the all one vector is the multiplicative identity. Finally, the additive inverse of a bit vector is the same vector. B XOR B is zero. Okay. So there are many examples, but the next example is something a bit peculiar. I take the set of integers, but instead of considering the standard integer addition and multiplication, I introduce two non-conventional operations. So this is defined as A plus B, and I am showing it with a circle here in order to distinguish it from the standard integer addition. So this addition is defined as A plus B minus 1 instead of A plus B. Whereas the product, which is A dot B, this is defined as A plus B minus AB. Okay. So this side, this plus, this minus, this product, these are all integer products, but now I have two special operations written within this circles. Under these two operations, the set of integer turns out to be a commutative ring with identity. Why? So let me give you a hint of the different, axioms, ring axioms. Commutative you can easily see because this is symmetric about A and B. If you interchange B and A, this and this remains the same. B plus A minus AB, so this is a commutative ring. Identity, we will find out what is the identity. Now, for example, you can check the associativity. Commutativity of plus is clear, right? This is symmetric about A and B. Okay. For example, you can check that both this and this are equal to A plus B plus C minus 2. Whereas, if I look at the product, you can easily work out this and this are both equal to A plus B plus C minus AB minus BC minus CA plus ABC. Then, we also need to check distributivity. Distributivity of product over addition. And again, it's an easy matter to check that this dot this and this dot this both evaluate to A plus B plus 2C minus AC minus BC minus 1. So these are easy checks, so I am leaving it to you. Now, what are the additive identity? Very funny thing about this ring is that 1 is the additive identity. Because A plus 1 or 1 plus A, same as A plus 1 minus 1, that is A for all A in Z. So 1 acts as the additive identity in this structure. Whereas, 0 acts as, additive inverse, let us first look at additive inverse. Additive inverse of A is not minus A, but 2 minus A. Why? You just plug in A plus 2 minus A equal to A plus 2 minus A minus 1, which is 1. 1 is the additive identity, not 0. The multiplicative identity is 0. Because A dot 0 or 0 dot A is nothing but A plus 0 minus A star 0 equal to A for all A in Z. Okay. So this is a peculiar ring. We will from time to time use this ring as interesting examples. Okay. Now, I introduce two concepts. One is called zero divisors, the other is called units. Okay. So, these are once again some definitions. An element is called a divisor of zero or a zero divisor if A multiplied by B is equal to 0 for some non-zero B. Okay. Then we can say that A divides 0. If B is 0, then this is not a good case. We will soon prove that anything times 0 is 0. It requires a little bit of proof. Anyway, we will do it. So, 0 divisor if A dot B is 0 for some B not equal to 0. Then we will say that A is a 0 divisor. Okay. And as I mentioned, A dot 0 is 0 for all A. Therefore, 0 is always a 0 divisor. But we are mostly interested in non-zero 0 divisors, which are also called proper 0 divisors, non-zero 0 divisors. Okay. Essentially, it says that you multiply two non-zero elements and get the 0. You will see that there are examples where this may happen. Multiply two non-zero things, you get the 0. Okay, so let us see where this may so happen. Then once again, this one by one, we look at all these examples. Z, Q, R, C, these are under standard addition and multiplication operations. Do not contain non-zero 0 divisors. You cannot multiply to non-zero integers and get 0. You cannot multiply to non-zero rational numbers or real numbers or complex numbers and get the 0. That is impossible. Okay. However, this is a non-zero matrix. This is also a non-zero matrix. But when you multiply, you can easily check that you get the 0 element, 0 matrix. So, these are non-zero or proper 0 divisors in the ring of matrices. What about the power set of S under symmetric difference and intersection? So, you take any non-empty proper subset A of S. Okay. Since S is assumed to contain at least two elements, S minus A, okay, you can find such a set A. And S minus A is also a non-empty proper subset of S. Therefore, these are non-zero elements. But if you multiply using this intersection, you get the null set, which is the additive identity of this ring. Okay. And what about that peculiar thing, Z circle plus circle dot? This does not contain non-zero 0 divisors, because if the product of A and B, which is A plus B minus AB, is equal to 1, then I bring everything in one direction, and we will get A minus 1 times B minus 1 equal to 0. And these are all integer operations. So this means A is, A minus 1 is 0, or B minus 1 is 0, or A, that is equivalently A equal to 1 and B equal to 1. But 1 is the additive identity in the group, not 0. Okay. So this also does not contain 0 divisors. Then we introduce the concept of units. Okay. Let R be a ring with identity or unity. Without that, it's not a good idea to talk about rings with identity, with units. Okay, so there is someone there. Now, an element A is called a unit if there exists a B such that AB equal to BA equal to 1. So, I often remove that dot sign for multiplication. Just write AB, BA by juxtaposition. Okay. So, if such a thing happens, then A is a unit, and of course B is also a unit. And we say that A and B are multiplicative inverses of one another. And we denote this as B is the inverse of A is the inverse of B. Okay. So now let us look at the units of our ring examples. The only units of Z under standard integer addition and multiplication are plus minus 1. So these are the only invertible elements. 2 is invertible, but its inverse is half, which is not a member of Z. Okay. So only plus 1 and minus 1 can be inverted, and they are their respective inverses. Okay. On the other hand, Q, R and C, you take any non-zero element, that is a unit. Okay, so these are good structures which we will call fields. Anyway, it will come little later. Any non-zero element can be inverted. So for example, if you take A by B, A not equal to 0, then its inverse is B by A. Okay, and so on. What about matrices? If you consider the ring of n by n matrices with integer entries, then you see that two matrices A and B multiply to the identity matrix. This implies determinant of A times determinant of B is equal to determinant of the identity matrix, which is 1. But since the entries are integers, determinant of A must be an integer, determinant of B must also be an integer. So the product of two integers is 1. Okay, therefore these individual determinants must be plus minus 1. Okay. However, if I replace this Z by Q, R or C, then the units are precisely all invertible matrices, that is those of determinant not equal to 0. Okay. Or non-singular matrices, whatever you call this. You can see that the only unit in the product set, power set ring is just S. And what about Z plus dot, O plus O dot, this particular thing. So let us see what can be the units. Now, let's say the product of this is 0. Note that 0 is the multiplicative identity, not 1, okay, in this ring. Equal to 0 implies A plus B minus AB equal to 0, and therefore I can write B as A by A minus 1. But now A and B are integers, therefore you can see that the only possibilities which make B an integer are A equal to 0 and A equal to 2. And if A equal to 0, B is 0, A is 2, B is 2. Okay. So these are the only units. Moreover, they are equal to their respective inverses. Okay. Okay. So, given this, I can now give a few definitions that R be a commutative ring with identity. So, these definitions always assume R to be a commutative ring with the identity element, multiplicative identity element. R is called a integral domain if R contains no non-zero or proper zero divisors. And R is called a field if every non-zero element of R is a unit. Okay, so using the concept of zero divisors and units, I can call sometimes a commutative ring with identity as an integral domain or a field. Okay, so once again let us look at, now we know our different rings, whether they contain zero divisors, non-zero zero divisors or units. So, Z under standard integer addition and multiplication is definitely an integral domain because you cannot multiply to non-zero integers and get this zero. But only units are plus 1 and minus 1, therefore it is not a field. Whereas, Q, R and C are fields because every non-zero element is invertible. The matrix rings are neither integral domains nor fields because they contain zero divisors, and not every element, non-zero matrix, is invertible. Okay, similarly you can check that the product set of S, power set of S under this operations, the symmetric difference intersection, neither an integral domain because it contains non-zero zero divisors. It is not a field because S is the only invertible element. Finally, you can see this contains no non-zero zero divisors, and therefore it is an integral domain. But this is not a field because only invertible elements are 0 and 2. Okay, so having seen these definitions and examples, let us now work out a few standard properties. These properties are fairly easy. Starting from the axioms, we can deduce these properties. So I will deduce some of these properties and leave the rest to you. Start with, this is a thing which we have implicitly assumed, but let me now prove it. In a ring R, the additive identity, what we call 0, is unique. Moreover, for every A in R, its additive inverse minus A is unique. Why? Proof is not so difficult. Assume that, okay, 0 and 0 prime are two additive identities. Then I have this, 0 equal to 0 plus 0 prime. Why? Because 0 prime is an additive identity, so 0 plus 0 prime must be 0. Moreover, since 0 is also an additive identity, 0 plus 0 prime must be equal to 0 prime. So you see that 0 is equal to 0 prime. Likewise, if B and C are additive inverses of A, okay, I have to show that B is equal to C. Then one by one, let us see. B is nothing but B plus 0 because 0 is the now established as unique identity, additive identity. So B is equal to B plus 0 and C is also an additive inverse of A. So A plus C is 0. Then I use associativity of addition to write this as B plus A plus C. B is also an inverse of A. So this is 0. 0 plus C. 0 is the additive identity. So this is equal to C. Okay. So these are standard proofs, but it does require some logical reasoning. Okay. Not difficult, but these things actually require some proofs. They are not necessarily automatic. And if we have a ring with a multiplicative identity, we have similar results and exactly similar proofs. I leave it to you to prove something similar to this. If R is a ring with identity, multiplicative identity, then the multiplicative identity is unique. Moreover, for every unit A in R, those elements which have inverses, multiplicative inverse is again unique. Okay, the proof goes exactly like this. So you furnish the proof completely. Then there is something called cancellation. If A, B and C are three elements in a ring, then if A plus B is equal to A plus C, then I can cancel that A and see that B equal to C. So this is called left cancellation. Likewise, I may have right cancellation. If A plus C is equal to B plus C, I can cancel this C and say A is equal to B. Why? This is because the inverse of A exists and is unique. Of course, uniqueness is not very important here. Why? So we have A plus B equal to A plus C. This in turn implies minus A plus A plus B is equal to minus A plus A plus C. So we add minus A to this same quantity, we get the same quantity. Now I use the associativity law of addition to see that minus A plus B is equal to minus A plus C. But this is 0, this is 0, so 0 plus B is equal to 0 plus C. That in turn implies 0 is my additive identity, so that implies B is equal to C. And for the second part, you have an identical proof. Right, I add minus C at the end. Okay, so I am leaving it. And what about cancellation for multiplication? This is not exactly so straightforward. We can for the moment say something like this, let R be a ring with identity. If A is a unit in R, then I can multiply by A inverse. Otherwise, we cannot. And this does not make any sense to cancel A. Okay. So if A is a unit and B, C are any elements of R, then I can cancel A. If AB is equal to AC, then B is equal to C. And if BA is equal to CA, then I can say B equal to C. Because this invertibility of A implies I can pre-multiply by inverse or post-multiply by A inverse. Okay. Otherwise, I cannot cancel in anything. Okay. But we will see an interesting result about integral domains where this cancellation is allowed. I will come to that little later. Okay, then what property shall we study? Yeah, now here is a set of elementary properties. Let R be a ring, ABC is in R. Then if I multiply the zero element with any element, A, I get zero. And the inverse of A is A. Here inverse is additive inverse. Inverse of A, additive in minus A times B is same as A times minus B is equal to minus of AB. And minus A times minus B is same as AB. So let us one by one make a formal proof of each of these statements. The first one comes from this. 0 plus 0 is 0. Multiply by A. You get A dot 0 plus 0 is equal to A dot 0. And then you use distributivity of dot over plus to show that A dot 0 plus A dot 0 equal to A dot 0. And I can write A dot 0 as A dot 0 plus 0. Okay. Because 0 is the identity. Additive identity. Now from this equality, I can cancel this. Okay. So now I can use cancellation. And what about 2? It is also fairly straightforward. Since minus A is the inverse of A, I have minus A plus A equal to A plus minus A equal to 0. But this shows that the inverse of minus A is also A. This is fairly obvious. What about this? Minus AB plus AB, you say. Then take minus A common. Sorry, B common, because distributive law holds, minus A plus A, 0, that would be, which is 0. Therefore, the inverse, additive inverse of AB, minus AB, is minus AB. And similarly, you can show the additive inverse of AB is equal to A times minus B as well. And what about the last? In the previous result, this I can write as minus A minus B. This I can write as minus AB, and then I use this to say this is AB. Okay. So these are all simple proofs. Now let's come to that important property of integral domains. If ABC are elements of an integral domain R and A is non-zero, then although irrespective of whether A is a unit or not, I can cancel A. Okay. So A is not needed to be a unit. Only thing we require is that A is non-zero. Then if AB is equal to AC, I can cancel A. Or BA is equal to CA, I can cancel A. Okay. Anyway, integral domain is a commutative ring. So AB and BA are same. Okay. Why? Now, one second, one by one, see the steps. AB is equal to AC. This implies AB minus AC equal to 0. Then I can use distributivity to show that A times B minus C equal to 0. And A is non-zero. If B minus C is also non-zero, then A and B minus C are non-zero, zero divisors. But since R is an integral domain, it cannot have non-zero, zero divisors, and A is already non-zero, so you must have B minus C equal to 0. Okay. That is B equal to C. Okay. So this is an interesting property of integral domains. Cancellation, multiplicative cancellation holds in any integral domain, but you cannot cancel 0, of course. Any non-zero element, you can cancel. Now there are a couple of properties related to fields and integral domains. Let us prove this. Every field is an integral domain. Let F be a field. As usual, you take two elements, AB, and write AB equal to 0. And you have to show that either A is 0 or B is 0. Okay. Then there are no non-trivial zero divisors. If AB is 0, and if I assume that A is non-zero, then it has an inverse. Okay. So, multiply A is a unit, and I can cancel units. So, we have AB equal to 0, and we have also proved that this is same as A dot 0, and since A is a unit, I can cancel A. Okay. And see that B is equal to 0. So, if A is not 0, B has to be 0. Therefore, you cannot multiply two non-zero elements and get the zero element in a field. Therefore, the field is always an integral domain. The converse of this is not true. For example, we know the set of integers under standard integer addition and multiplication is an integral domain, but not a field. However, there is an interesting property of integral domains and fields. Every finite integral domain is a field. Okay. This proof is also small and simple, but requires some argument. So, I have to show that any non-zero element in a finite integral domain has an inverse. Okay. So, what should I go? Take any non-zero element, RBA. An integral domain consisting of only finitely many elements. So, take any non-zero element in R. Now, consider the map from R to R that takes X to AX. So, this is multiplication by A map. Okay. Now, since A is a unit, if AX is equal to AY, A is a non-zero element, and by this result, if I have AX equal to AY, non-zeroness of A means that I can cancel X. So, X is equal to Y. Okay. So, AX equal to AY, and the non-zeroness of A implies that X is equal to Y. So, this map is injective. But it is a map from a finite set to itself. So, if it is injective, it has to be bijective or surjective. For infinite sets, this need not hold, but for finite sets, an injective map from a set to a set of the same size, or maybe itself, must be. If it is injective, it must be bijective too. In particular, it is surjective, so there exists some x such that ax is equal to 1. Okay. Because 1 is an element in this integral domain, ax equal to 1, but then we have proved that A is invertible. X is nothing but A inverse. Okay. It is invertible and A is a unit. Okay. So, having seen this simple properties, I would like to introduce two other concepts pertaining to rings before stopping this lecture. The first one is called a subring. Okay. Let R be a ring. Okay. A non-empty subset S of R is called a subring of R. If S is a ring under the operations plus and dot inherited from R. Okay. So now, let us, before seeing some examples, prove an interesting theorem. Then we will see some examples, because this theorem will make the proof of subringness fairly straightforward. S is a subring of R if for all AB in S, A minus B and AB are in S. So, closure under subtraction and multiplication is a sufficient condition for S to be a subring. Actually, it is also a necessary condition. Anyway, so if only this closure properties hold, then S is a subring. Why? First of all, you know that commutativity of addition, associativity of addition, associativity of multiplication, distributivity of addition over multiplication, distributivity of multiplication over addition. This is a mistake again. Just so have these two things. Distributivity of this over this. Okay. Not the other way around. Okay. So these are already inherited from the parent structure R. Okay. And since S is non-empty, we can find an element A in S. But since I can take A equal to B, A minus A equal to 0, then this is in S. So, S contains the additive identity. Once I have S, I can take this as 0, this as A. Then I can see every element A has its additive inverse in S. Okay. And what else do I have? Okay. I have to show closure under addition. So, for AB in S, we have A plus B, nothing but A minus minus B. I have established that since B exists in S, minus B also exists, and A plus B is nothing but A minus minus B. So, by this, this is also an element of S. So, S is closed under addition, and definitely it is given that it is closed under multiplication. Okay. So, the importance of this theorem is that given a subset S of S ring R, if I want to establish that this is a subring, I only have to check that closure under subtraction and multiplication holds. Okay. I do not have to check all these six, seven properties one by one. Only these three and these two closure properties suffice. Okay, so now let us see some examples. Z is a subring of Q, R and C. Naturally, Q is a subring of R and C. R is a subring of C. Okay, simple examples. If I consider all multiples of n for some positive integer n, then this is a subring of Z. Why? Because if I take nA, another element nb, then na minus nb is once again a multiple of n, n times a minus b. Moreover, the product of na and nb is also a multiple of n. Okay. So, by this closure properties, this is a subring. And this is a more, I would say, complicated example. Let us consider all 2 by 2 matrices of the form x, x, x plus y, x plus y, where x and y are coming from z. So, this is a subset of M2z, 2 by 2 matrices with integer entries. And why is it a subring? Because you can easily check these two equations hold. If I subtract one matrix of this form, one matrix of this form, then this remains of the same form. And more importantly, also, if I multiply these two such matrices, you can see that I once again have a matrix of this form. Now, this is my x and this is my y. Okay, this is once again of this form. So, this is a subring of M to Z. Good. Okay, so that leaves us with the final topic of today's lecture, homomorphisms and isomorphisms of rings. Okay. So, let R be a ring under the operation plus and dot. And S is another ring under some other operations, plus and dot. Okay. A function from R to S is called a homomorphism of rings or a ring homomorphism if for all AB in R, we have this two. FA plus B is FA plus FB and FA dot B into FA dot FB. What does it say? It says that you take any two elements from this, first add them using the rule of R, then you apply this function F, you get some element in S. If instead you first apply the function F on these elements A and B, and then add them up using this rule, these two elements must be the same. And that is true for all A and B in R. Likewise, if you first multiply A and B using this multiplication, apply F, you will get the same element if you first apply F on this individual elements A and B and then apply this dot. Okay, this. Okay. In other words, F commutes with addition of the two rings and multiplication of the two rings. And finally, a definition. If you have a bijective homomorphism, we call it an isomorphism. Okay. Of course, we will not study homomorphism and isomorphism much, but I think it is a good idea to have a brief introduction to such concepts. Okay, so let us see some examples. Consider the field C, okay, and the map C to C, taking a complex number to its complex conjugate, you can easily verify that this is an isomorphism of fields, okay. And if I consider 2 by 2 real valued matrices, this is a ring we have seen, R is definitely a field, and if you consider a map that takes a real number A to A00, this kind of special kind of matrices. This is definitely a homomorphism of rings. It is easy to verify that these two conditions are satisfied. Finally, this is yet another example. Consider again 2 by 2 matrices. Now I make a map from complex numbers to this. So input is A plus IB. And I convert it to matrices of this form AAB minus B. I leave it to you as an easy exercise that this is a homomorphism. Okay. Now let us see a surprising example of isomorphism. This is quite, I would say, startling. So you know that Z under this normal integer addition and multiplication is a ring. And we have seen that there are two other operations that we have defined earlier, and Z is also a ring under these two operations. This plus and this dot, where this plus A plus B is defined as A plus B minus 1. These are integer operations. This is this group operation, this group's, rings plus, and the multiplication we have seen to be A multiplication B is A plus B minus A. Okay. Now this Z and this Z, they are the same sets, but the operations are different. Okay. One is normal operation, the other one is this peculiar operations. Okay. So now I define a map from Z to Z itself that takes F of A is nothing but 1 minus A. Okay. Now I verify that this is a homomorphism, in fact, an isomorphism from this ring to this ring. Why? So, this is because of this. On the one hand, F of A plus B, okay, you make the addition first and then you apply this formula. This maps to 1 minus A minus, 1 minus A minus B, 1 minus A plus B, which is 1 minus A minus B. On the other hand, if you first apply F individually on A and B, then apply this plus operation, you will get 1 minus A, this plus, then use this formula, 1 minus a plus 1 minus b minus 1. This simplifies to 1 minus a minus b, which is same as this. Likewise, the same thing holds for products. By this definition of f, f of ab is 1 minus ab. On the other hand, if you first apply f, then this product, this will be 1 minus a, product this, and you do this calculation, this will also evaluate to 1 minus ab. And you can easily see that this is a bijective function, a to a 1 minus a, this is definitely a bijective function. Therefore, this f is an isomorphism from this to this. Okay. So, this is an interesting and counterintuitive example, but anyway, this illustrates the concept of homomorphisms and isomorphisms. I think it is good. Now, a few properties of homomorphism and isomorphism. I just mention this and prove some parts of it. And let us stop after that. So, let f be a homomorphism from R to S. Then, there are several things that hold. First, the homomorphism maps the 0 element of R to the 0 element of S. And it maps the inverse of A with respect to this, it's the inverse of F of A. Okay. And then you have F of NA, where NA is defined as N fold sum of A plus A plus A N times. That is equal to N times F of A for all A in R. N is Z. That means you can allow negative things because of this. Okay. And f of a power n is f of a whole power n for all a in R, but this I cannot take perhaps n negative. A inverse need not always exist. So, if I take n greater than equal to 1, and if a is a subring of R, then f of a is a subring of S. These are all easy assertions to prove. So, one by one, let me prove all these assertions. First, we know 0 plus 0 in R is equal to 0. Now, if I apply F on it, what do I get? F of 0 R is equal to F of 0 R plus F of 0 R. And by the homomorphism property, this is equal to this, this. Now, S is the identity, 0 S is the identity in the ring S. Therefore, I can also write this as this. 0 s plus f 0. Now, if I look at this and this, I can simply cancel this and say that f of 0 r is 0 s. Okay. And what about if given this 1, I can prove 2 easily. F of a plus minus a is nothing but f of 0 r. By this, this is 0 s. And by the homomorphism property, f of a plus f of minus a is equal to 0 s. Okay. Therefore, f of minus a is the additive inverse of f a. For 3 and 4, you can use induction on n along with 2. And 5, let me prove it. Since a is a subring, it is non-empty. Therefore, f of a is also non-empty. Now, I have to show that given any two elements here, u and v, u minus v belongs to the same set, and the product uv also belongs to this set. Okay, if I can check this, I am done. So, take any two, u and v in f of a. Since this is f of a, we can always find elements a and b in this such that u is f of a and v is f of b for some ab in a. Now, a is a subring of R. Therefore, a minus b and ab, they belong to a. Okay, so let us look at ab first. A is a subring, so a minus b is in a. Now, if I apply f on it, f of a minus b, is f of a minus f of b equal to u minus v. That is f of something, therefore it must be in f of a. Similarly, you show that f of ab is in u product v is in f of a. So f of a is closed under subtraction and product. Therefore, it is also a subring. And this is a last theorem for today. Now, I assume that f is a homomorphism of rings, but this time I assume it is surjective. Without this assumption, none of the following conditions is perhaps true. Okay. And s is greater than 1 anyway. This is a surjective ring homomorphism, 1, 2. Okay. Then, if R has the identity 1R, then f of 1R is the identity of S. Second assertion is that if A is a unit in R, then f of A is a unit in S, and f of A inverse is f of A inverse. So, this inverse is in R, this inverse is in S. Okay. Finally, if R is commutative, then S is also commutative. Okay. I will prove only part 1, other parts can be similarly proved. Okay. So, take any u in S. Okay. Any element. Since this is surjective, u is the image of something in R. Okay. Since f is surjective, I can say u is equal to f of a for some a in R. Now, it's just a matter of simple calculations. U is nothing but f of a, and a I can write as a dot 1r. By the homomorphism property, this f of a dot f of 1r, which is, but f of a is nothing but u dot f of 1r. Okay. And likewise, we see that if I just write this a as 1r dot a, u is f of 1r times u. So, for every element, if I multiply u by f of 1r, I get u. And for every u, if I multiply u from the right by this quantity, I get back u. So, this has to be the multiplicative identity by definition. Okay. I think that is all. Let me just verify. Okay. Yes, that is all for today. Let us stop. After this, groups will be introduced, and finally, I will continue the study of rings and groups, and we will see some applications of groups and rings in cryptography. Okay, see you.